Most people out there believe that motion control gaming started with the Wii, but that's not exactly accurate. There were a ton of other products that were introduced before the release of the Wii that also had motion control abilities. For instance, there was this one weird device that we took a look at a while ago called the PowerPad Tilt for the Super Nintendo, and while that did track motion, it wasn't very good at it. But even before that, there were other devices introduced that didn't actually require you to hold any controller at all, like the Sega Genesis Activator, which was this weird device that you'd put around your body and you'd flail your arms all over the place hoping that it would actually work. That too, also, wasn't very good. And even before all of that, most gamers out there that know quite a bit about video game history would probably say that the true originator of all motion controls was the Power Glove. And that was a really bad device that also, too, itself wasn't very good. But I found out something that completely blew my mind, because even before any of those devices, back in 1981, a company called Datasoft introduced a motion controller for the Atari 2600. What was it called? Well, it was called the LaStick. As far as I can tell, this is the very first commercially available motion controller released for any video game system. Initially released by Datasoft in 1981, this controller was created by a company mostly known for developing and producing video games, and really not hardware. But that's what makes this so cool. The controller was pretty expensive at the time, being sold for around $40 American, but it also happened to be a really ultra-premium controller. It's got nice, thick, rubberized grips, the whole thing has a button at the top that feels really well made, and it also has a switch inside that you can activate by squeezing the controller to lock your motion in place. This isn't a kid's toy. Though it probably was aimed at kids, the idea of this thing was to make something a little bit better than you probably would expect it to be. So how did it work? Well, they didn't use motion control technology that we have today, like gyroscopes and accelerometers. They decided to use something completely different that was very reliable at the time. They used mercury switches. Mercury switches. With mercury. Now look, there's plenty of devices out there that have used mercury in the past, like thermostats and thermometers. And those aren't really toys though, they don't have to be something that a kid would be playing with, and typically they're well managed by parents who know what they're doing. But this is a controller, and the controller may have actually gotten to some kids' hands over the past 30 years. And do you know what kids like to do when they play a video game that they're not good at? They like to throw the controllers. Maybe they might get angry or be very rough with it, and that's something that, personally, I don't want to risk. This controller is over 3 decades old, and the chances of somebody breaking one of those hermetically sealed pods inside and having mercury leak out may have actually come to pass. But we have to test this controller out in the safest conditions that we possibly can, because mercury is poison! So, we're going to test out how this controller works and if they had a good reason to use mercury in the first place. Let's take a look. In the PowerPad Tilt controller, there was a tilt switch. Essentially, it's a tiny little device that has a ball inside that can move around back and forth, and eventually, if you move it just in the right way, it will touch 2 prongs, bridging an electric connection that will activate the switch. A mercury switch works essentially in the same way, but instead of using a metal ball, they use liquid mercury, which is a metal and is also conductive. So why would you want to use one over the other? Well, in some instances, a tilt switch just isn't very reliable. If you move it in just the right way, the ball won't move properly and you won't be able to bridge the connection. But mercury, well, mercury moves really fast, and because it basically coats the connector prongs, it is far more accurate and reliable and makes a far better conductor when dealing with these kind of switches. The LaStick wasn't the first use of mercury switches in gaming. All the way back decades before the release of the controller, they also used mercury switches in pinball machines as a mechanism to find out if people were tilting the machines. I'm not gonna say that the LaStick is the best motion controller in the world, because it really, really isn't. But what it is a very good example of what motion control technology was like back in the day. And for that mark, well, it's really not that bad. Now look, there's gonna be a bunch of games you'll play like Donkey Kong or Pac-Man, and those games specifically require precision input. Now what I mean by that is any game that requires direct left, right, up, and down at specific points in the game. Like for example, in Donkey Kong, when you're trying to go up and down a ladder, that can be very difficult with a motion controller because sometimes it can't identify the actual direction you're trying to point in. I found myself struggling to make movements that would have been very easy to make with a real Atari joystick. But still, I was capable of completing the game at least one way through, telling me that even then, you can still play with this controller if you really wanted to. And I can't ignore that really high quality button at the top. Because I could count on Mario jumping every time I pushed that button down without fail, I knew that I could focus a little bit more on the directions of his movement. Buttons on controllers from this decade are usually hit and miss, especially the third party ones, but this one is so good it even surpasses some of the first party controllers I've used from this era. So, with that in mind, I decided to play a game that required very few button inputs at all. Miss Pac-Man. This game is all about directional movement while you're playing, and let me tell you, it didn't work that well with this controller. When you play this game with the normal Atari 2600 joystick, it's very easy to play because you just have to tap in a specific direction. Even if you were to let go of the joystick, Miss Pac-Man will keep moving until she hits a wall or something like that. So why is that a problem with this controller? Well, when you're trying to make a specific movement that you can't achieve, you'll sometimes put yourself into a situation that you can't recover from. It doesn't make Miss Pac-Man impossible to play, but it does make it far more difficult. And that difficulty increase can be found in a lot of other games, like Pitfall, which typically wouldn't be too hard to play with a regular joystick, but with motion controls, the accuracy simply isn't there. To pass this screen in Pitfall, you're supposed to avoid the water and jump on every single crocodile head. Now, this isn't a very difficult task to do with a regular joystick, but when it comes to using motion controls, it becomes even more complex. Keeping the controller in a specific position mid-air while also pushing a button to jump, and then bringing it back directly to the center to make sure you don't keep moving, well, that's just really, really hard to do. The controller squeezing function that cuts movement sometimes does work, but I really just couldn't get used to it. A regular Atari joystick is just way easier to use, and adding more functions only adds to the complexity of playing these games. But something else I noticed while playing River Raid was that the controller seemed to be able to detect a small amount of movement. If I slowly moved the controller in any of the directions, it would kind of just tap the movement a little bit instead of just giving it a direct input. That way, it kind of made it feel like it was sort of an analog joystick. It was a strange sensation, and it didn't really help me when I was playing a lot of games. But then I tried out Missile Command, and well, this kind of was surprising. Missile Command on the 2600 really doesn't work that well with a joystick because originally you would have used a trackball to play this game in arcades. But when you play it with this motion controller, suddenly it makes a lot of sense. The movement just clicked, and I found myself very easily being able to aim at targets without any issues. I think the reason Missile Command works so well with this motion controller is because, well, there's no limitations on where you can aim. Missile Command has no lanes or hallways or anything like that, so you can aim anywhere on the screen that you want, making this controller ideal for this situation. This shows some promise into the technology that Datasoft had created, but at the end of the day, most games just won't work that well. And when you go to play something like Asteroids, where you probably expect it to work great, then you realize that in Asteroids on the Atari 2600, you have to move the joystick forward in order to move forward. And doing that with a motion controller is just not good at all. You'll flail your hand around trying your best to get hold of your ship, but like this and many other vehicle-based games that require you to move forward, it's just something that doesn't work or translate well in motion. If they added some directional buttons on the controller so that you could use that in combination with movement, that might have solved this problem, but that's something they didn't do. Only a handful of games really work with this controller well enough, and even the ones that do, well, you could still get away with just using the regular controller bundled with your Atari.
So, should you get it?
Well,
no, it's not safe. This is one of the strangest controllers we have ever taken a look at on the show. And to be fair, it's something that I think is an interesting collectible for those out there that are interested in this kind of stuff, but it is a dangerous device that has dangerous components inside. And while our device worked fine and didn't seem to leak anything, that might not be the case for everyone else out there. And that's just one of the issues with this controller. The idea that there's a device out there that people could have been manhandling for decades and accidentally dropped it and broke a little hermetically sealed tube inside that would leak out mercury, that's just something I don't think anyone should have to risk when playing video games. But what should you do if you find one of these things in the wild? Well, to be honest, I really don't know. We can't throw the one out that we have because where we live, this is a toxic substance and it basically can't be thrown out in the garbage. So what we decided to do with ours is give it to a museum because we think they know how to handle these things and it is a piece of video game history. But if you have one and you're a little bit nervous, just don't let kids play with it.